Okay, so searching for the chat. Sorry guys, I'm trying to search for the live link so that I can see the chat live. If I don't find it in 3 minutes, I will start directly the lecture and that's it. Here we go. Okay, let's wait for the others. Can you hear me by the way? I'm trying to use another microphone. Sassa, nice. Thank you, Luca. So, let's wait another couple of minutes. I'll put this guy here. Okay, so I will say let's start. The others will reach us, if any. So guys, today we are going to speak about particle localization. So we will take the particle filter and apply it to the same localization problem that we see for the Kalman filter. Okay, so the scenario is the same. We have our differential drive robot navigating in a 2D environment. The robot is controlled by V and omega, translational and rotational velocities, and in this case we sense 2D landmarks. Actually, in the slide is written that they are uniquely distinguishable. That's a mistake, sorry for that. In fact, we are going to perform also the data association that for particle filter is quite interesting. But the location of those points in the world, so we can perceive it as 2D points, but their location in the world is known. Okay, so we have just to understand where the robot is in this environment. So approaching the problem in this case, so what are the difference with the Kalman filter? Of course, the first one is how the distribution over the state, so our belief, is represented. In this case, we have a particle distribution, so we can imagine it as a set of points, and each point carries a certain probability mass, which is represented by the weights. So in the modeling of this problem, so in constructing the particle filter machinery, we have to take into consideration almost the same thing that we have in a Kalman filter with some additional steps and something that we have to remove. For instance, we have always to define the state domain, eventually find the Euclidean parameterization for the state, defining the controls, defining the measurements and transition and observation functions. We don't have Jacobians in this case, but further we have to design a sampling resampling strategy to perform after the update in order to cancel the particles that don't carry so much probability mass and try to replicate the ones that instead are representative of the problem, let's say, of the correct estimation, for better saying, or a good estimation at least. So the inputs, as always, are the controls, so the velocity measurements and the landmark observations that we observe 2D, so a full observation of the landmark. And as a prior, we have our fantastic map, which is populated with 2D points, as always. So the domains, this basically stays the same, right? We have our state space, which is an SO2 object. Then we have 2D controls already integrated over a certain time interval. So we have directly the displacement in translation and the displacement in orientation, let's say. And then we have the space of the observation, which are 2D points, so just 2D coordinates. For simplicity, we can represent the state as a 3D vector. In the particle filter, that's not mandatory in a way, because we are not representing a Gaussian distribution, so we actually don't need a vector that is used to represent the mean and the covariance of our belief. But potentially we can keep the SE2 object, so a transformation matrix. Here, for simplicity, let's say, to simplify everything, we stick with the same parametrization that we use in the Kalman filter, okay? And the rest is the same. Same transition function, as we already said, so the unicycle model integrated using the Euler integration, so nothing new until now. Also, the observation function is actually the same, so we take the inverse transform about the current estimate of the robot pose, we invert it, so to bring a landmark in the frame of the world, in the frame of the robot, and that's the predicted observation about a specific landmark. So far, so good. If we see, as always, k landmarks, we're just stacking the observation in a gigantic vector, so our vector of predictions, and then this is going to be compared with the set of observation that we have in that specific time instant, okay? And in this sense, we have to perform also the data association between the landmarks in the world and the observation that I get, okay? Now, the control noise is the first real difference between Kalman and particle filter. So the set of particles that represent our belief in fact represent a set of hypotheses about the possible location of the robot, right? So while the Gaussian distribution have a single maxima, so the mean, and so is called in mathematics, I think, monotonic function, I don't remember the exact word, but it basically have a single maxima, okay? So there is a single most probable hypothesis, let's say. Here we have multiple peaks in the distribution, in the sense that each particle, in fact, represents a different hypothesis, and its probability is represented by the weights itself. So actually, we can have multimodal distributions for our state. So to maximize the effectiveness of this representation, what we actually do in the control noise is that we apply a different sample from the control distribution for each particle. So each particle is going to get a slightly different control. In this way, we maximize the diversity of the hypothesis over the estimation process. So I'm starting from the state. I have 1,000 particles, so I will sample 1,000 different controls, sampling the noise from my control distribution, and then I will apply that individually to each particle. So each of these will end up in a different location, and this represents the variety, let's say, of the hypothesis that I'm carrying on during the estimation process, okay, if that's clear. Also, for the observation model, we have our measurement affected by Gaussian noise, but in this case, we have also to define the likelihood, so the probability of our prediction, let's say, given the state, okay? So P of Z given X. This, in fact, can be an arbitrary distribution. It can even be represented by a piece of code. It don't have to be strictly a proper distribution, let's say, even if in most cases it is, in fact. So in our case, to simplify, let's say, and for the fact that we have also a complete 2D sensor, we decide to represent this likelihood as a Gaussian distribution, okay? So in fact, it's basically a Gaussian. If you see this formula, we miss just a constant term C here, so basically it's a Gaussian. And here we take the difference between the prediction, so the predicted observation, and the measurement. and this is the Mahalanobis distance over the covariance matrix of our observations, right? Then we take the exponential, and this for us is the P of Z for the ith, let's say, landmark, okay? Then the product of this thing defines the complete distribution. So for a single sample, for a single landmark seen by a single particle, that's the formula, okay? So we take this guy and we just take the exponential. Now, the prediction step. So as we said two slides ago, basically we are applying a different control to each particle. So, and once we have this control, we just pass the particle inside the transition function. We can do it even if it's not linear because it's a pointwise representation of the state. And of course, the weights doesn't change because this function, in fact, affects just the position of the particle. So here is the effect that you see, like starting from a localized robot, let's say, so all the particles are concentrated in a single location, and then repeatedly applying just the prediction step without an update, you will see that the particles over time start to spread in space, because of course our uncertainty about the state will increase if we just perform the prediction step, as we already see in the Kalman filter. In that case, our covariance was increasing. In the world, let's say, of the particle filters, the goodness of this step is even more evident, because in a way, if we are spreading the particle more in different locations in space, we are increasing the number of hypotheses that we can carry on. So once the correction step arrives, we have multiple possibilities that we can explore to understand where the robot is. Okay. So that's the prediction code. So we take the set of samples, and of course in this case samples represent just the location of the particle, because we don't need the weights to perform the update, and inside the transition we find our lovely velocity measurements. Okay, so we take the dimension of the particles, we take the velocities, take it in absolute values, and here we compute the value of the noise, so the sample in a way, for our controls, and here we update the particle location. So we take the particle it, we apply the motion model with the control sampled by this distribution over here, and we update the location. So we implement in fact exactly this formula over here, where the transition the motion model is the same as for Kalman, so your integration of the unicycle. Now the update, as I tell you at the beginning, in fact we are performing the data association on the fly, let's say, during the update step. So we're trying to understand, given an observation, to which landmark in our map this observation belongs. Now we will perform it in a greedy manner, in the sense that each particle filter in fact perform a different data association. So we will repeat the process of data association for each particle. And if you think about that's pretty logical, right? Because when we see data association, we in fact see that basically we are trying to compute the minimum of the Mahalanobis distance between the prediction and the observation, right? For each possible combination of landmark observation. Now, of course, if I am in a different location, so if I'm observing a different landmark, the value of this Mahalanobis distance will change, in fact, because it's dependent on my location. So while for Kalman, for the fact that I have just one hypothesis, let's say, that's the hypothesis, I mean, a most probable configuration of the state, then I have to perform the data association just once. So just for the mean of my distribution, in fact, we were using mu. In the case of a particle distribution, I have all of these hypotheses. So for each of these, I have to recompute the gigantic matrix in a way. So the cost matrix A, and then find the minimum of rows and columns and blah, 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 and everything that we see in data association. But I have to consider the specific location of that particle, okay? So we have to perform data association, and at the same time, we have to update our weights, right? So we can do this operation at the same time, basically, and that's what we're trying to do right now. So we take the sample. So this is the location of the heat particle, okay? For this guy, I compute this entry. For each possible combination, landmark prediction, sorry, measurements, okay? So all the combinations, I have n landmarks, m observations, I compute m by n times this formula, varying the entries, of course, okay? Then I will have, of course, a set of landmarks that are not observed, and we will discuss it in the next formula. So once I've done that, what did I do? I do something really stupid in a way. Let's say we are, I am applying just gating. So I will take the minimum of the cost over the rows, basically. So my matrix is number of measurements times number of landmarks. I will fill it for each particle, and then I will say, okay, find the minimum over this row, right? So for this measurement, take the closest landmark in the sense of the Mahalanobis distance, and that will be my association if the distance is below a certain threshold, okay? So pure gating, and that's it. So, and that will be my designed association. So the landmark that associate with the corresponding measurement, okay? So far, so good. So here I solve the data association. At the same time, in fact, for the fact that I choose as a likelihood the Gaussian distribution, you recognize that this term, in fact, is the same as this term, right? So while I'm performing data association, I am actually also evaluating the likelihood. In particular, I'm taking the maximum value of the likelihood given the state and given the observation that I see, okay? So while I'm performing data association, I can also evaluate this function, so the update for my weights, and in particular, I will take the sum over these guys. So these are the minimum for each measurement of the Mahalanobis distance, right? So I will take all these values and I will sum it up, and this represent the likelihood of the landmarks that I associate, right? Plus, I have to consider all the landmarks that I did not associate, right? So the ones that, for instance, don't fulfill the gating heuristic. And for each of those, and the number of dropped measurements are this guy, k, I will choose a value as, let's say, a regularization term in a way, so an L miss. So this will be the fraction that I give to the likelihood if that position is not able to associate a landmark, let's say, okay? So then I will sum it up, that's a negative likelihood, negative log likelihood, so I will take the exponential, and this will give me the likelihood of my sample. And this guy will be the one that I use to update the weights of my particle, so the probability mass that that particle carries. Is this process clear, guys? You have any question about it? I have the usual 15 minutes of delay. Here to sample particles. Okay, in the setting that you will see in the exercise, I was speaking just in general about the algorithm. In fact, at the beginning, we will sample from the uniform distribution, right? So, and then my likelihood is sort of a Gaussian. So you can try to guess, actually, what's the distribution that we are trying to mimic. And if you think about the problem itself, we are trying to localize a single robot having full observation about the environment, right? So this distribution resembles a Gaussian even in logic, right? I can be just in one place if I can observe exactly, so in a fully definite way, the surrounding environment, right? The only possibility is that the environment is somehow repetitive or redundant, then there I might be in two different places at the same time, but in our setting, that's actually a Gaussian distribution, okay? I don't know if that's a reply to your question, Akash. So basically, the beginning is uniform, and then we are going to converge to a Gaussian distribution in this specific problem. Okay, that's nice. There are any other questions? Okay, seems no, so I will proceed with the lecture. So by doing both things, so data association and evaluation of the likelihood, we somehow speed up the computation for a single particle, but if you think about the fact that we have to repeat this whole process of constructing the matrix, evaluate the minimum over the rows, for each particle, you will see also while we are running the algorithm that, that everything gets super, super slow. And the main reason is that we are using a really greedy way of performing data association. A much efficient way will be to use what the professor just explained to you 2 hours ago, let's say, during the fine neighbors lecture, okay? But for now, we stick with that. So that's our update code. So you can recognize here the usual definition of our sigma z. We already pre-compute the inverse to avoid inverting all the time. For each particle, we initialize the gigantic matrix and we take the corresponding sample. Then, for each landmark and for each measurement, right? For each landmark that we see, so for each observation, we get the prediction here by our measurement function, which is the same basically of the Kalman filter. Take the observation, then here we compute the delta, meaning measurements minus the h, so the prediction, and here we compute the cost for mn, so we are going to use omega z noise, of course. So we fill this matrix. Once we complete this step, and then we will see the other snippets of code later, we have this value that we just computed over here, so this guy. And we will just multiply it by the previous value of the weights to get the new value of the probability mass. So, really, really easy. So, once we have done that, basically we have reshaped our distribution, right? Because all these peaks now move, someone is getting higher, someone is getting smaller, etc., etc., etc. Now, it's quite useless to carry on the estimation. So, all this computation that we have to do, the data association and blah, 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 for a particle which actually carries a really low value of the weights, so a really small probability mass, because meaning that for with all the measurements that we integrate until now, this particle is not representative of our distribution, right? It's not representing a piece of the distribution which is really meaningful, okay? It's sort of the tail of a Gaussian, you can imagine it, right? So we want more sample with a high probability mass. So to do so, we perform this sample-resample sort of strategies. So the weights, in fact, define a proper probability distribution in the sense that they have to sum to one. So we take these weights that after the update are not set to sum to one, in fact. So we will take the set of weights, normalize them, and this defines a sort of a discrete distribution, right? Where each weights represent basically an interval inside which we will sample that specific particle to which that weight is associated, okay? So we take this discrete distribution and we sample a set of indices from this discrete vector, right? Of course, the number of indices that we sample is the same of the previous step, just that thanks to the fact that particles that are more representative have a high weights, those particles will be sampled more often, of course. So we are basically multiplying the number of particles with high weights, and we are reducing the number of particles with low weights, okay? Just by performing this uniform sampling, right? So now we take those new particles, so some of them will be like multiplied. Of course, maybe we want to apply also a small noise to differentiate between two copy of the same particle, just to move it a bit. Then once we have this new set resampled by our weights distribution, we have to renormalize the weights, of course, because now the distribution is again not a real probability distribution, right? Because the weights are summing to something which we don't know, okay? But for sure it's not one. So we renormalize the weights and we obtain our new particle distribution after the update. And then we repeat this process over and over again. Of course, that this part is almost the most important, right? Because first it allows us to carry on hypotheses which are meaningful for the problem. And second, it guarantees that after the update, the particle distribution is still a valid probability distribution, even if it's discrete in a sense, okay? So that's the update of our weights. So once we have this matrix filled that we see before, we compute the negative log likelihood, okay, for everything, summing all this stuff. Of course, if we drop some measurement, we have to fill it in a way. And then we compute this summation, which is this guy over here. So number of measurement dropped times L miss, which is the discount factor that we choose, minus the sum of the properly associated measurements to landmark. Okay. So once we have this gigantic summation, we take the exponential and we just apply it to the weights. And that's what you have to do in this piece of code, right? And here we have the uniform sampling. We fill it already for you to make things, easier. So how it goes? We take the number of weights, so the dimension of the weights, actually, right? So this corresponds to the number of samples that I have in my distribution, because I will have one weights per sample, right? That's the normalizer. So I sum up all the weights, one divided, that's the normalizer that guarantees that the weights after the multiplication by this guy will sum up to one, okay? That's the number of desired samples, which of course will coincide with this guy in most of the cases. Then we have the beginning and end of our fantastic discrete distribution from which we are going to sample again, right? And that's the cumulative until now. So for all the weights, we take the weights at index something times the normalizer, and this sum equal our cumulative function, right? Until the cumulative is greater than this guy, I will sample the index of the corresponding weight. Meaning, if the guy is small, right? It's really, really small. This thing is gonna be always greater than this guy. So basically this thing will be skipped somehow. If the value of the cumulative increase over time, I will add and add sample of that copy. So I will take the sample, basically takes a uniform sample, which sample the indices of particles with an I weights. Taking those indices, I will take the previous samples, once new weights, wait a sec. They are refilling it later. Okay, I got confused. I think this thing should be moved here for clarity, but anyway. So take the previous sample, and here we say, okay, the new weights are just, each weight is one divided the number of particles. So this will sum to one, basically. So it became, again, sort of a uniform particle distribution. Then I will just take those indices and resample the particles according to what I do with the previous weights. So these indices will have multiple copies of particles with an I weight and less copy, of course, of particle with small weight. So by using these indices to copy the corresponding samples, I will basically perform the sample-resample kind of strategy, okay? So that's actually finished the presentation. I know that this uniform sampling code, and it's strange at the beginning to understand, let's say. But I hope you have clear at least the general process of how it's working, sample-resampling, and why it is useful for the particle filter. So if you have any question about that, I will say it now, so then we can go directly to the coding part, okay? So I'm looking also at the chat so that I can use the slides to reply eventually. if any. Otherwise, we will switch to practical. I think we are completely cooked by the lectures of today, completely. Destruction lecture. Okay, guys, so I will say let's switch to the meet so that you can see the code itself. So Giorgio, I think he will send it on the email as usual. So see you there in 5 minutes, I guess.